morning. This is Apostle John Welty with Second Eighth Week Ministries, and today is Sunday, February 10th of 2013. Thank you for joining me. We're going to be continuing on in Colossians chapter 1, picking up around verse 5 where we left off last week. So if you'd like to have your Bibles out and have them open there, that'd be great. Let me just do a little rereading here to put us back into the context. So Paul, okay, he is writing this epistle. And he begins with identifying himself and his position in God's spiritual government as a living steward of the knowledge of the mystery of Christ. Okay, that knowledge, which provides the foundation for our faith. Okay, that for our faith to function, we must be building upon a solid foundation. Christ is that foundation. When the doctrine that we receive is through His stewardship, right? And God provides instruction in His doctrine through His apostles. This is how Christ ministers truth to the church. You see this confirmed throughout the scriptures. Okay? He did so also prior to the new covenant of Christ. You see this also with Moses. You see this also with David. And with the prophets continuing to confirm that stewardship that came by Moses. Okay, you see God revealing a pattern for building and for function of faith for the priesthood. You see that with Moses for the tabernacle. You see that with David receiving the pattern and the blueprint for the building of the temple of stone. Okay, same thing. God reveals the pattern which is necessary for function in order to for faith to be found pleasing in His sight and received by Him. Okay, and that's the pattern that the Spirit enters into to make faith living. That's the pattern. Okay, when the tabernacle was built according to the pattern shown to Moses, okay, then the Spirit entered in to sanctify. Okay, same thing with the temple. When the temple was built by Solomon according to the pattern that was shown to David, right, they had to work with that knowledge which had been received through His stewardship. Okay, a steward of God's selection, not by the will of man, not by the aspiration of man, but by God's selection. Okay, God selected, separated, and prepared a steward, right, to make known the pattern for His building, okay, for faith to function within that pattern, within that framework, okay, through a steward of His selection. He continues to do so when Jesus came. Jesus did not change that pattern, did He? Okay, He provided knowledge through His apostles in order to instruct the church, which you see in Acts chapter 2, verse 42. With the birth of the church, okay, they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship. The apostles were sent to teach. The apostles were sent to instruct, to lay this firm foundation of faith. Now in the epistles, okay, we see the apostles that are addressing, there was already false doctrines that were entering in, causing faith to stray from that original pattern, from that original doctrine, which is what we see in the epistles. Okay, so the epistles were not written to teach the foundation knowledge of Christ. The epistles were written to address false doctrines, which were causing those that were giving ear to that false knowledge. It was causing them to begin to stray. Okay, in this epistle of Paul to the Colossians here, okay, you can see that there were those Judaizers, okay, who were entering in and trying to mix the covenant of Moses in with the covenant of Christ, right? Telling people that, well, the doctrine that you received from Paul is all right, but he missed out these things. These things need to be added in order for your faith to be completed. That was a good starting point. But if you really want to get deeper, you need to have these things of Moses. Okay, and you can see that you see in chapter 2, we'll get to that, where these things are being addressed. So the people that think that they have no need for the stewardship of living apostles don't understand what the apostles were writing with these epistles. They were not teaching them the doctrine of Christ with these epistles. They were correcting thinking. But if you don't have that foundation, then you're not going to understand what these letters are about, because these letters are making reference to and pointing back to a foundation of knowledge which had been taught by the apostles but is not taught by these epistles. Okay, and that's why it's absolutely essential that we receive that one truth, that one doctrine, because it's by that one doctrine that we work with this, with the Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit will work with no other doctrine, which is why we see in the those that are trying to draw near to God through the three P's of the false religious system, which is the the pulpit, the pew, and the plate there, right? Okay, they think that they're going to be able to touch God through those things, and they think that they're drawing near to God through those things, but they're not. Okay, the pulpit is actually complicit in that error, because while they promise people one thing, they're delivering another thing. Okay, they tell them that there's liberty in Christ, and yet their confession is sin and death. Okay, that's what they're familiar with. That's what they continue to struggle with and against. And they're not abiding in Christ. They're not walking by faith. They're not following after the Spirit, because if they were, their confession would be Christ. But it's not. Okay, they project Christ, but they confess sin. Okay, so out of the heart, they're confessing sin. With their lips, they're confessing Christ, but by their works, they deny him. That's what the apostles were addressing. That's hypocrisy. Okay, that's hypocrisy. They're trying to clean the outside of the cup, just like the Pharisees and the Sadducees did. Okay, they tried the same thing. Through the doctrines of men, they tried to present a form of godliness, but it was without power. And that's what Jesus was addressing to the religious leaders of his day, and that's what the apostles were addressing. The apostles set truth within the heart so that those who would receive this knowledge through his stewardship, okay, would be able to keep their hearts free from the defilement of the false knowledge of the world, that they would work only with that foundation knowledge of Christ, keeping their faith within the framework of truth, using only the tools which had been sanctified by God for faith, so that their faith remains sanctified by truth, as Jesus said, as recorded in the Gospel of John. Okay, because it is then that we have learned by that knowledge, that foundation knowledge, how to walk and please God. We need nothing outside of Christ to add to that. And that's what Apostle Paul is addressing here with this epistle, because there was those who were trying to add to that foundation knowledge of Christ, saying that there was something else that was necessary, okay, apart from prayer primarily in tongues, preaching, prophecy, gifts, callings, graces of God, government, truth, and spirit. These nine things, okay, are the tools. These things, which the apostles frequently write about, these things, that's what they're talking about, these tools. Okay, prayer, preaching, and prophecy, gifts, callings, graces of God, government, truth, and spirit. These are the nine tools of the new covenant priesthood of Christ. These are the contact points for our faith, because Christ is in these nine things. Okay, he allows us to join ourselves to him, joining our faith to him through these things, which are sanctified. These are sanctified for that form of contact. And if you're trying to draw near to God through any other things, then you're using the tools of the world, as Paul addresses here in chapter 2. But let's get into that. So let's read through here a little bit. Like I said, I just wanted to give you a bit of a framework as we continue to expound upon this epistle here. So Paul, as I said, begins, he identifies himself, chapter 1, verse 1. He says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timotheus, our brother, to the saints and the faithful brethren in Christ, which are at Colossae, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord, and the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which you have to all the saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof you heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel, which has come unto you as it is in all the world, and brings forth fruit as it does also in you since the day you heard of it and knew the grace of God in truth. As you also learned of Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is for you a faithful minister of Christ, who also declared unto us your love in the Spirit. Okay, so let's go into that a little bit more. But you can see here what Paul is talking about. Okay, he is confirming that foundation knowledge of Christ, which had been taught to them. Okay. which they learned of Epaphras, okay, who had instructed them in this foundation knowledge of Christ. Okay, Paul is confirming that doctrine, which is the apostles' doctrine. Okay, you'll notice this epistle is not making that doctrine known, but he's referencing that. He's confirming that. Okay, that truth is what sanctifies your faith in Christ. By sanctifying your faith in Christ, okay, that has to do with providing for separation. Okay, there is separation from false doctrine when your faith is following after truth. Okay, when you embrace truth, okay, you are ingesting that which God has provided for your faith. Okay, as you ingest truth, which is that pattern of knowledge, okay, which gives direction for faith, keeps our faith joined to Christ. Okay, truth is knowledge which makes all the necessary connections for your faith to be joined to Christ perfectly. Perfect faith. Okay? And our faith must be perfect to be found pleasing in the sight of God. Don't let anybody tell you any different than that. Okay, your faith must be perfect. The flesh is not perfect, okay? And they like to talk about that a lot, but they use that as an excuse for their faith also to be not perfect. But God doesn't accept that. Okay, God judges all things according to the measure of his own holiness. Faith must be perfect. And faith can be perfect when you have truth. Okay? And that's what they lack. They talk about truths, okay, because they're all going around trying to glean little nuggets here and there and trying to build for themselves little altars. And those altars reflect their own image. Okay? That's why it's called idolatry. Okay? The altars that they build by gleaning little nuggets, okay, they each have their own truth. Right? And they all try to hold people accountable to their own prejudices and their own perspectives. Okay, so each little denomination's got its own little flavor and twist, and they hold they set accountability, okay, within the individuals. Okay, personal accountability, but that's not the government of God. The government of God sets accountability in Christ, in His truth. We are all accountable to this one yoke of knowledge. All right, so all those that keep covenant with God continue to confirm and to confess Christ according to this one doctrine, confirming this one spirit. And those of faith recognize that voice, okay, because they are also working with that same voice, that same doctrine. Okay, it's truly incredible how the Lord truly knits us together. The fellowship that we have in Christ is nothing like the fellowship that we had in the false religious system before coming into covenant. Okay, because the Spirit of God is actually carrying this knowledge within our hearts and strengthening those that we're sharing with that are receiving the same knowledge. And it's you literally experience that. The Lord provides tangible evidence through the Spirit, okay, confirming Christ in this knowledge, confirming Christ in our faith, and confirming the fruit of faith within our hearts, okay, through this exchange of His knowledge. This is the spiritual priesthood of Christ. This is what Apostle Peter was talking about with the spiritual sacrifices and the spiritual priesthood. Right? This is the knowledge that the apostles taught. This is the knowledge that the apostles continue to teach today as God has now restored apostles to the church, okay, so that faith may be rehubbed and joined back to Christ. Okay? But you see in this epistle that at that time faith was already beginning to stray from that doctrine. Okay? 2,000 years later, it didn't correct itself. Okay, in the absence of apostolic stewardship, okay, here you had the living apostles who had taught this doctrine. Okay, were having to already make corrections, okay, to those that were trying to stray from it and mix other knowledge with it. Okay, do you think that in their absence over the last 2,000 years that it all corrected itself? Okay, the same thing happened with the leaders that Jesus was addressing during his earthly ministry. Okay, that for 400 years the Lord had been silent, okay, since the prophets, and what state did he find the church in? The believers there, the assembly of the believers. Okay, he found them in a state of error, didn't he? Okay, there was confusion. They were being ruled by doctrines of men, and they were trying to set righteousness within themselves. Okay, they were very confused, and he had to correct that. He corrected their thinking by sharing with them the knowledge of the kingdom of God from the perspective of the throne of God, because they had taken the scriptures which were inspired by God and they had turned them in order to confirm the flesh. Okay, and that's what happens. Okay, that's what happens in the absence of stewardship. Okay, people interpret inspired writings from their own darkened perspectives, and they take a different meaning away. Okay, they read one thing that was meant to say that was referencing something else, but they take it to confirm something dark, okay, something that keeps them tethered to the soil. Okay, that which was written from the perspective of the throne is now being interpreted from the perspective of the soil. Okay, and that's what Satan encourages. Okay, Satan encourages that. You notice that Satan quoted scriptures. Okay, didn't he? He quoted scripture to Jesus. So the scripture, okay, didn't sanctify him, did it? The scripture didn't make his faith perfect. Okay, so the people that think that their faith is being joined to God through Christ because they read their Bibles, they stand in error. Jesus himself addressed that. Okay, you see that in John 5, around 37 through 40. Okay, Jesus himself said, the scriptures will not join your faith to me. Okay, you think they will. You think you're going to have eternal life by your study of the scriptures. Okay, but that's not true. You have to obey the voice of the Lord, and the voice of the Lord is speaking to you right now. Okay, he was standing before them, speaking to them, and all they saw was a man, right? Because they were refusing the grace of God. The grace of God was present to draw faith from their hearts and to assist them in joining their faith to Christ. Okay, but they refused that. They were resisting. They were hardening their hearts against that grace, that power, that voice that was present. Okay, it's just as when God testified of Christ and said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." Some people only heard thunder. Okay, they refused that witness of the Father. Right, but those of faith, okay, heard the voice of God, and they recognized that God was confirming this man. This man standing before you is my Christ. Okay, listen to him. Same thing Moses had written. Okay, that there's one that comes after me. Okay, that you obey him. Okay, obey his voice. This is that Christ. So, getting back into here, let's jump into my notes. I think we left off in verse 4, but let me touch in there a little bit more because I had a few more thoughts that we didn't get to last week. So in verse 4 and 5, we see faith, hope, and charity. Okay, as Paul also wrote in 1 Corinthians 13:13, where he says, "And now abide faith, hope, and charity, these three, but the greatest of these is charity." Okay, we're seeing this in verses 4 and 5 here. Okay, which says, "Since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus, and of the love which you have to all the saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, where have you heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel?" Okay, truth. Truth was necessary. Okay, truth was necessary. And charity is a twin. Okay, charity and truth are elements of the gospel of Christ. There's 12 elements of the gospel of Christ. These 12 elements make up the foundation knowledge of Christ within the heart. It's as we receive instruction in each of these elements, where we begin to learn from God's perspective the boundaries that he set for each element, okay, and the function and the purpose and the design of Christ, which we see in each of these elements, okay, to where grace, I mean the first element of the gospel, okay, is not simply God's unmerited favor, as you hear being preached and taught by so many people in the world today. Okay, they've taken that definition of grace, okay, in doing so they have removed that element from the gospel of Christ, okay, and now they're using it to confirm themselves. Okay, they do the same thing with love. Love and charity are the same word, right? So love and charity, this is what he's talking about here when he says, "We heard of your love, which you have to all the saints." That's charity. Same thing that Apostle Paul was talking about there in 1 Corinthians. Okay, they take that word and they say, "Well, God is love." And they say, "And therefore that means..." And they draw their own conclusions. Okay, they say, "Therefore, that means that whatever I decide to do and whatever emotions I feel is sanctified for faith." Okay, that expresses Christ, but it doesn't. Okay, love and charity are is the same word. Okay, and truth and charity are twins. These are twin elements. Okay, truth has to do with that foundation knowledge, which contains all of the facts that remain consistent with God's character, purpose, and plan. Okay, it makes all the necessary connections for your faith to be joined perfectly to Christ. And it's with truth, okay, that our faith is sanctified. We use truth, we resource truth, we resource that foundation knowledge that we receive from his apostles in order to keep ourselves unspotted from the world, as we saw earlier in, I believe that was in we're going through James, right? We're keeping our faith unspotted from the world. We do that through truth, which sanctifies faith. Okay, Christ sanctifies faith by providing these things, this knowledge, this power of his Spirit, okay, these tools which join us to him by his Spirit. Okay? These things are tools which we resource in order to, in order for faith to build and grow. Okay, and for that fruit of faith within the heart to continually be nurtured, so that our faith is not continually joined to the things of the world as they're trying to do from the pulpit. And they want to try to join faith to the things of the world. They want to try to change the world and call that faith. Okay, so they're very active in you know, political movements and all of these different things because they want to try to change the world. And yet, that's not what God has called us to. He's called us to the priesthood of Christ, okay, in order to change faith, so that faith would be separated from the world, and that through the sanctification of faith, that we may grow in the knowledge of Christ daily through the priesthood of Christ. Okay, this is why apostles are sent, in order to restore through instruction truth to the church, because it's only by this knowledge that we begin to learn what is sanctified by God and what is not sanctified by God. And when you use only the things that are sanctified by God, then you're now working with the Spirit of God. Okay? Apart from truth, people think they're working with the Spirit of God when they're not. Okay, they're working with unclean spirits, and they're addressing. They think that Christ is in everything that they favor. Okay? If they like that, then that must be of God. Therefore, my faith is joined to Christ in that thing. Okay, and this is where we see there'll be many that that say, you know, here's Christ, here's Christ, here's Christ, but that's don't follow after them. Okay, I have provided one foundation of truth. Okay, abide within that truth and you'll be free from idolatry. Okay, this is what God has provided for our faith through Christ. This doctrine, the Spirit, these tools, which keep our faith joined to him. Keep our faith fruitful, which is what he's talking about here in this epistle. Okay, so love, or charity, as I said, these are synonymous, gives expression to truth. So when truth is in the heart, okay, the love of God is received. I mean, God expresses love, that's giving expression to Christ, expressing his virtue towards us through his government, truth, and Spirit. As we receive that in our hearts, it takes the form of truth. Okay, so the expression of God's love towards us takes the form of truth within the heart when we receive this instruction through the headship of Christ. Okay, then, as we resource that knowledge within the heart and give expression to that, that's charity. Now that's unfeigned charity, because charity gives expression to truth. Therefore, without truth, there can be no love. All right? Without truth, there can be no love. Now, God pouring out his grace to awaken, he pours out his Spirit upon all flesh to awaken to the need for Christ. That does not instruct them in truth. Okay? He also not only awakens them, but sends forth apostles in order to teach them. Okay? If they refuse his apostles, then the awakening doesn't benefit them. Okay? If you refuse those that he sends, then you don't benefit from what he's provided. And he has provided for a redemption through Christ. But if you refuse his apostles, you refuse instruction in truth, okay? But you have received the baptism of the Spirit, then how can the Spirit benefit you? Because the Spirit works with this knowledge. But if you refuse this knowledge, then you're refusing that which the Spirit works with. Therefore, you're choosing to work with another spirit. Okay, and this is what people don't understand today. They're making tremendous errors in judgment because they have not truth. They know not the Spirit of God. Okay, and they're trying to do whatever they can to rekindle that awakening that they experienced. All right, when God did minister grace to them to awaken them, but when you share truth with them, they refuse it. Okay, because that requires responsibility, that they have to take on that yoke of that knowledge and labor in faith with the priesthood of Christ. Okay, they don't want that responsibility. This is why they're willing to receive the definition of grace as being God's unmerited favor. There's no responsibility for them in that. God loves me. Great. Awesome. Okay, now let me go about my day. But when they understand that we are responsible to that which God reveals to us. Okay, the grace of God has to do with revelation. Okay, he is communicating to us for a purpose in order to give direction for faith. And he directs faith into the covenant of Christ. The apostles provide knowledge which makes known all the necessary connections for your faith to remain joined to God through that covenant. Okay, so when they refuse truth, okay, what are they leaning towards? They're leaning towards the counsel of the enemy, which is telling them, you don't need truth. God loves you. God's love. Okay? Grace is God's unmerited favor. You already have that. What do you need truth for? Okay? You see that? And then they continue to struggle in sin. They continue to struggle with iniquity. And as Apostle James brought out, why do you see these things happening in your midst? Is it not because you're working with the wrong spirit? Okay? You've strayed from truth? Okay? You're standing in double-mindedness? Okay. The apostles addressed those concerns then, and it's still happening today. Okay. God is providing correction through truth. He provides truth through his apostles. It's through this knowledge that we keep ourselves free from defilement. Okay. But we have to labor with this knowledge. This is a responsibility that we have to continually reflect upon this doctrine, to continually offer our spiritual sacrifices of praise towards God, giving expression to this knowledge, okay, that we reflect upon the grace that we receive as the Lord, through dreams and visions and manifold graces, continues to confirm Christ to us individually. Okay, he's confirming Christ to us in this knowledge and in these tools. He's confirming his work within our souls. Okay, we reflect upon that daily. We are hungry for that witness and that testimony from above, and we're willing to receive it, reflect upon it, okay, and labor in faith with that. We steward these things. We're growing in a new experience, one that we did not have in the false religious system, because now we're experiencing Christ in his fullness. This is the confession of Christ, okay, because you're speaking about what you're experiencing. Okay, when they confess Christ by quoting scripture in the false religious system, which we all did prior to coming into covenant, or at least most of us did, when they're confessing, what they thought what they were doing, confessing Christ and quoting scriptures, all right, they testified of sin and death and iniquity in their hearts, okay, but they spoke by quoting scripture and said, well, yeah, that's my confession of Christ. That's a projection, okay? They're trying to put forward something that does not agree with that which is within. That's hypocrisy, okay? That's hypocrisy. There was no power to affect change within the heart. Okay, therefore, they're not able to confess Christ because they're not experiencing Christ. And when we talk about confessing Christ, it has to do with confessing or giving expression to that which is taking place within the soul. Okay? You have to be experiencing regeneration. You have to be experiencing the work of Christ within the heart in order to give expression to Christ. If not, then you're simply giving lip service to God. Okay? There's no reality in that. Okay? So he talks about here that we heard of your faith in Jesus Christ. He's talking about your fruit, okay, which can be measured. Okay, it can be measured through your charity. Okay, our faith can be observed and measured through the three C's of conformity, consistency, and communication. These are the three C's by which our faith is measured. Okay, conformity, consistency, and communication. We are molding our confidence with the knowledge and the tools of Christ. And this is, and we're daily giving ourselves over to the use of these tools through study, through the labor in faith, with prayer, with the offering of sacrifices, okay, and sharing this knowledge with one another. Okay, this is the true fellowship of Christ, this exchange of this substance. Okay, this is living substance which gives life to the faith, gives life to faith in our hearts, okay, and builds up the body of Christ. The body of Christ thrives, okay, on this substance. This is the substance that the Spirit of God feasts upon within the heart. Charity. Okay, charity is substance. Okay, it's giving expression to that which is within the heart, which we receive from above. That substance is of God. It's from his throne. It's not the substance of the world. It is not touched by death. Okay, it is free from sin. And so that's what he's talking about when he says faith here. He's talking about fruit. Okay, that fruit. So this is not flowery words. This first chapter of this epistle is often read as if it's just some kind of flowery introduction to more things that he was writing. And you can see them talking about faith, hope, and charity. He's talking about truth. He's talking about apostolic governance here, isn't he? Okay, he's setting their He's setting their thinking here. He's providing a framework for this epistle, okay, putting confidence within government, truth, and the Spirit. Okay, that's what he's doing here. Okay, that these are the things that join your faith to Christ. Okay, these are the things that are necessary for faith. These are the things through which faith is made perfect. Okay, therefore, these are the things that we're going to continue to share, expound upon, and set our focus upon, because it's through truth that our hope and our expectation is set in Christ. Our faith is set in Christ through truth. Okay, these things are necessary for our faith. These things, okay, this knowledge and these tools, these things pertain to life and godliness. Okay, they are essential for the life of the soul. Okay, the soul is designed for this substance. And apart from Christ, apart from this knowledge, apart from these tools, apart from these things that Christ ministers to us and provided for our benefit upon the cross, okay, apart from these things, the soul suffers. Okay, that's what you hear people talking about in the false religious system. They're going to church, they're reading their Bibles, okay, but they're confessing sin and death, because they're confessing that their souls continue to suffer, which testifies of being separate from Christ. Okay, if your faith is joined to Christ, then that's not your experience anymore. You're not going to continue to experience that any longer. You're going to experience the victory of your faith being separate from sin and death. Okay, you're no longer using those things which rob the heart of faith. Okay, now you're using those things that build and increase faith within the heart. Okay, your faith thrives in Christ. That's not the testimony of the people that say they're Christians. Okay, but they have no understanding of the covenant of Christ. They have no understanding of the priesthood of Christ. Okay, they see no need for apostles. Okay, and yet they remain in bondage to sin and death. Okay, that's a strong delusion they're under there. So also here when he says in Christ Jesus, you can I've got the word in bold in my text here. Okay, in Christ Jesus, not without, within. That means there's boundaries, doesn't it? Okay, God has clearly delineated the boundaries of the covenant of Christ. Okay, therefore your faith can be in covenant and your faith can be out of covenant. If you don't know what the boundaries are, then you don't know whether your faith is in God or out of God. Okay, you don't know whether you're working with the Spirit of God, which functions within the covenant, or you're working with another spirit that's masquerading as the Spirit of God. Okay, how would you know? You have no discernment. So you can see also that truth, this element of the gospel, provides discernment for faith, doesn't it? You know, we're able to discern between the clean and the unclean. Okay? So when someone comes to us and says that something needs to be added to this gospel, we can reflect and say, well, this doctrine that I received, okay, which was profitable in joining my faith to Christ, and that God himself continually bears witness to me every single day since I've been keeping covenant for, 11 years now or so. Every single day, okay, that I exercise my faith with this knowledge and with these tools, God continues to bear witness to Christ, okay, in these things and testifies of his work within my soul. Okay? I can look back through my reflection books, okay, and see this evidence that the Lord continues to provide to me, okay, that my faith is pleasing in his sight, and he continues to sustain my faith daily through this knowledge and through these tools. It's truly incredible. And absolutely every day. This without ceasing for 11 years. Okay, that was not my experience in the false religious system. Okay, I had a lot of people that thought I was saved and thought I was a Christian prior to coming into covenant. Okay, but God was still issuing grace for salvation to me. Okay, and I began crying out for truth. Okay, when I began crying out for truth, and the Lord introduced me to Chief Apostle Eric, and I began to receive instruction from him. At first, I challenged that and tried to resist that a little bit. But as I began to prepare arguments against the knowledge that he was sharing with me, the Spirit continued to minister to me that I was standing in error. Okay, and that was confirming the knowledge that was being shared with me through this living apostle. So it's incredible, and I thank God for winking at my ignorance. Okay, that he, instead of condemning me for my ignorance, granted me access to his grace, so that I could continue to learn of him received this doctrine. And as I said, for the last 11 years, okay, nothing needed to be added to that doctrine. Okay, nothing. The same doctrine that he had received, many years before that, okay, Chief Apostle Eric, Chief Teacher Maria, had been functioning in that knowledge, that one yoke, one spirit, okay, for many years prior to that, is the same doctrine, the same yoke, the same spirit that I've worked with for the last 11 years. Okay? And I've daily been daily partaking of that witness of God and continuing to confirm that one record. Okay? And as I said, it's completely different than my experience prior to coming to the covenant. So when people want to try to say that that there's something lacking in my faith, I have quite a bit to reflect upon here as far as my experience with God confirming my faith in Christ. And that's what Apostle Paul is talking about here to the Colossians. Okay, he's pointing to the things that matter to God. Okay, you receive doctrine through the headship of Christ. Okay, you're in recognition of God's spiritual government. And that doctrine is what God had issued from his throne for your faith. Okay, your faith is bringing forth fruit. Okay, you're experiencing that faith. Your faith remains in Christ. Okay. And others, elders of the church here, are able to testify of your spiritual growth because of they're able to measure and observe your faith through your function in the assembly, that you're offering your spiritual sacrifices, and that your understanding is increasing. Okay? You're handling these things with faith in your heart, and the Spirit of the Lord is bringing forth growth and increase in your understanding. This is what all those that keep covenant with God experience every single day. And it can be measured, it can be observed through the three C's. And this is what Paul's saying here. These are the things I want you to reflect upon. Okay, so when someone comes to you and says, you don't need what Apostle Paul taught you, okay, you need something that Moses taught, you need to add that to it. Then you can look back upon all of these things. Well, then why am I bearing forth fruit? Okay, why is the doctrine that I received through apostles why am I experiencing the cleansing of the conscience? Why am I experiencing increase in growth and understanding? Okay, I'm not struggling with sin and death any longer. Okay, so why are you trying to tell me I need to add anything to it? And that's what Paul is addressing here. He's pointing to the things that pertain to life and godliness, to set their focus upon Christ, and that therefore, when someone comes and offers something other than Christ, you'll be able to use truth for discernment and say, I don't need that. Okay, so this is what he's doing with this epistle. But you can see that the people today that are trying to read this epistle without truth in the heart, okay, they read something totally different. Okay, it's like reading somebody else's mail. You don't know the perspective or the thinking of the person that wrote the letter, and you don't know the perspective and the thinking of the person that the letter was written to. You're just a third party trying to read somebody else's mail and figure out what's going on. That's what happens when people try to read the scriptures apart from stewardship. Okay, which is why Peter warned that there's a lot of people that read the scriptures to their own destruction. Okay, to their own destruction. Same thing Jesus said. Okay, you search the scriptures because you think there's eternal life in them, but you won't join yourself to me. Okay, you're actually using the scriptures inspired by God, okay, inspired by me, by men who were writing, who were listening to my voice and writing down the grace that they were receiving. They were speaking from that experience of working with the grace of God, and they wrote these scriptures. Okay, this is what inspired writings are. It's holy men of God. Okay, these things weren't for private interpretation. Right? You can't take these things and separate them from the covenant. You can't take these things and separate them from the perspective of God. You have to read these things from the light of grace. Okay, you have to work with the grace of God. Then this knowledge is made living. Then this knowledge begins to you have understanding from above. This is what it means to walk uprightly. Okay? But when people try to take the scriptures and use them to confirm themselves and to confirm their own prejudices, or to find some kind of inspiration to pursue an aspiration, okay, they're separating these things from the throne of God. Okay, which is like breaking a branch off of the vine. Okay? It's not going to grow anymore. And any fruit that was on it is going to shrivel up and die, right? Because it's been severed. That's what happens when they take scripture and use it for themselves. Okay? If you try to build an image of yourself with scriptures, which is what happens apart from stewardship, okay, you're going to find that whatever you build shrivels and dies because you don't have power to sustain it. Okay, only God can sustain the knowledge of Christ. Therefore, if you try to take this knowledge outside the covenant, it's going to shrivel up and die. The same thing we see with the manna from above, right? Okay, those that took that manna and kept it in jars because they wanted to make sure that if God didn't give them manna tomorrow, they'd have some, right? Okay, he told them not to do that, but there was people that did. And when they did, it turned into maggots, right? Okay, it was no longer useful. Okay, because they had deviated from what he had said. They were not obeying his voice. They were not putting their confidence in him. Okay, they decided to take matters into their own hands. That's what happens when scriptures is used for private use through private interpretation. Okay, God does not sanctify that activity for faith. It's not faith in Christ. Okay, and this is why they continue to confess sin and death, because they're reading the Bible, but continuing in sin. Okay, Jesus said, "Go and sin no more." Okay, you have to be working with my spirit, my doctrine. Okay, your faith must be joined to me. And that's what he was telling the Pharisees and the Sadducees there in John chapter 5. So when he talks about love here, he's saying in Christ Jesus. In, as I said, delineated by truth. Okay, love is not Adam's benevolence, it's the expression of that truth. Okay, love can only be expressed from within Christ. Okay, if you're without Christ, you cannot express love. You can express feelings and emotions, but you cannot express the love of God. Okay, when he talks about love here, he's talking about the love of God. That's the expression of his virtues. His virtues cannot be expressed from without Christ. They can only be expressed from within Christ. Okay, if they could be expressed from without Christ, then Christ didn't need to come. So when people try to elevate their own feelings and emotions, okay, and that love that they find within themselves, when they try to elevate that to the love of God, they're actually casting Christ down. Okay, underfoot, saying that we don't need you, we have this. You already had that. Okay, you already had that. Okay, you know, I've heard some prominent, leaders in the false religious system, you know, say that, loving yourself, you know, and I responded to them that, you know, Jesus did not need to die on the cross to help people love themselves. They already love themselves. They're lovers of self. Okay, that's the condition, okay, that keeps people in bondage to sin and death. Okay, he came to provide a new covenant, new knowledge with new tools so that we could use these things which are sanctified by God to separate ourselves from the world, to separate faith from the world, and that we could serve God with perfect faith. Okay, they see no need for that. They see no need for that. Which is why they stand in error. Okay, but God is now telling us, and thank God for providing apostles again, to restore faith back to Christ. That faith must be perfect. Not only can faith be perfect, but it must be perfect. And it is truth, okay, which allows faith to be perfect in Christ. Because truth makes known those boundaries. So now you can choose whether you're going to abide in Christ or not. Without that knowledge, you have no choice. Okay, you're just in bondage. So those that think that they're free to choose for themselves and they have some kind of freedom apart from apostles are wrong. They're actually in bondage to sin. Yeah, they have no freedom to that. They're not choosing the yoke of their deception. Okay, and God is assigning assigning that to them. They don't have a choice over it. So again, so love is not Adam's benevolence, okay? It's the expression of Christ in faith, okay? It's not emulation, okay? Emulation is an expression of iniquity, okay? There's hypocrisy in emulation, okay? Because you're trying to put forth and give expression to something that's not within yourself, okay? There's a disconnect. That's hypocrisy. So the love of God is only in connection to the covenant, which sets the restrictions for this expression of truth. Okay, so it's important to keep that in mind. So you see here also that charity, or love, is the distributing factor of his virtues. Okay, this is why Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 13:13, now abides faith, hope, and charity, these three, but the greatest of these is charity, because charity is the distribution factor of his virtues. Okay, having received the grace of God in truth within the heart through instruction, by his apostles. Okay, we are daily cleansing ourselves through the use of this knowledge and through the use of these tools, but it's as we offer up our spiritual sacrifices and give expression to this knowledge and give expression to this new experience that we're having with our interaction in the kingdom of God, okay, that we're daily functioning in the priesthood, we're daily partaking of that other kingdom, which is invisible to this world. Okay, but we are functioning in it. We are learning by this knowledge to function within that kingdom, to work within that framework and that system and that design which God has provided to redeem the heart, to salvage the soul. Okay, actually, the Spirit searching the caverns of the soul to bring forth healing and cleansing. Okay, that which the church wants, okay, but doesn't understand. Okay, this is what God's providing for us as we keep covenant. All right, and this is what we're giving expression to through charity, and this is where we see the distribution. There's a there's this through this exchange of substance, okay, that faith is increasing exponentially. Okay, there's an exponential growth. So the more we sow, okay, the more we grow. The more we sow, the more we grow. That's what we see here with charity being the distributing factor of his virtues, which is, as I said, that's why Apostle Paul is saying the greatest of these is charity. And he's not saying that you don't need faith and hope. He's not saying the other elements don't matter, okay? But he's saying that there's a purpose, okay? God is providing these things for your increase, and we see the increase in charity. Therefore, there's a purpose, okay, that the water's not just flowing in and not flowing out, okay? That there's a circulation taking place. This is the purpose and the design of Christ. Okay? This is why God sent forth to receive back to himself. There's an exchange and a flow taking place. This is what we see with charity. Grace in, charity out. Grace in, charity out. There's a continual cleansing taking place within the soul through this. Okay? And this is through the priesthood of Christ. This is what's taking place within our hearts daily, okay, as we serve him at the altar using these tools. Praise God. And so we also see that that we cannot express, okay, that which we do not possess. Okay, you cannot express what you don't possess. Right? To try to do so is hypocrisy, as I said. So his virtues must first be in the record of our faith, and then charity can bear witness to Christ in us. Okay, so the record must first his virtues must first be in the record for our faith. We cannot choose any record to follow. We have to follow the record that God provided for our faith, which is the record that's set in Christ and made known by his apostles, okay, beginning with his baptism to his death on the cross and his resurrection. This is what we're following. Okay, so you can also see that it's because the false religious system is trying to use their own signature. Okay, they're trying to use what they find within themselves, okay, in place of the love of God. They're trying to find what that benevolence they find within themselves to replace the love of God. It's because of that their acts of benevolence have no power for them to bear all things, believe all things, hope all things, and endure all things. Okay, why aren't they able to do that? Yeah, they say they have such great love for God, but they're not able to bear all things, believe all things, hope all things, and endure all things. Okay, their lips testify against their experiencing Christ. Okay, because when you experience Christ, okay, you do have this power. You are working with that power. Okay, and this is what you experience daily. Okay, so why aren't they experiencing that? Okay, it's because their faith is not in Christ. Okay, the virtues of Christ are not in the signature of Adam, but they're in the record of God. Right, and we had to first be willing to receive these things from above for our separation and for our cleansing. Okay, that's absolutely essential for our faith to be made living by the Spirit. Then, by that power of the Spirit working with this knowledge, right, and entering into our labor of faith with these tools, that we experience that power to bear all things, believe all things, hope all things, and endure all things. That is the common salvation of those that walk in righteousness. Okay, that's the common salvation. Okay? But you hear people, they talk about that like it's pie in the sky. That's the daily experience of those that keep covenant with God. Why is it something that they're trying to reach for? Because they're standing outside. They're standing outside. They want what we experience inside the covenant, but they want it out there. Okay, they don't want to have to enter into covenant to partake of Christ. Okay, they want Christ out there. They want Christ in the world. Okay, that's what they want. Okay, and in doing so, they're fighting against God. They're resisting his government, truth, and spirit. Because God sent forth his apostles to say, no, Christ isn't out there. Okay, and he's not there to confirm your aspiration. He's not there to confirm your principles. Okay, he has provided this covenant for your benefit, that by this covenant you could learn of his priesthood, and that through this priesthood you could experience the cleansing work of Christ within your heart. And as you experience that work within your heart, your faith would be sustained in him. Okay, perfect faith sustained by the Spirit of God. Daily increase, daily overcoming. What are we overcoming? Ourselves, the world, and the devil. Okay, we're putting to death our own principle and our own aspiration. We're not using those things for faith. Okay, even though those powers exist to try to distract us away, okay, from the covenant of God, okay, we're overcoming that by choosing instead to reflect upon what God has provided for our faith and labor in faith with these things. This is what Apostle Paul is addressing here. Okay, reflect on those things that you've already received. Okay, don't reach for the things, they're making your promises. Oh, no, there's something else you haven't seen yet. Okay, don't reach for those things. Just continue to reflect and build on what you've already received. This is what God has provided for your faith. This is what's necessary for your faith to be perfect in Christ. Therefore, don't reach without Christ to try to add to it. There's nothing outside of Christ that's necessary for faith. These things, okay, pertain to life and godliness. Okay, with them we have power to bear all things, believe all things, hope all things, and endure all things. Okay, so let's go on here in verse 5. I've only got about 9 minutes left, so I had a lot I was reflecting upon there that I hadn't gotten to yet. So, but in verse 5, he continues on, "For the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, where have you heard before in the word of truth of the gospel?" Okay, the word of the truth of the gospel. So that hope he's talking about here. This is a supporting element of the gospel. Now, Christ is the hope of the righteous. Okay, truth sets our hope in Christ. Now, a lot of people think their hope is in Christ because they're hoping for Christ to do this and this and this for them. And so they say, well, yeah, they hope in Christ. Okay, that's, truth does not set your hope in Christ in that way. Okay, Christ has to do with his work within the soul. First, foremost, this is the will of God. Okay, that he would, that the love of God would be perfected within our hearts. Okay, which has to do with that which is being received is bringing forth his work, cleansing within the soul, bringing forth, you know, seeding the soul with the incorruptible seed of Christ, okay, and that seed is daily being nurtured through contact with him, daily contact, okay, not once a week, not once a month, not once a year, daily contact. We're daily laboring in faith with these tools, and through that daily contact, this seed is being nurtured. The seed is being daily exposed to grace and to the nutrients that God is providing. Okay? It says the nutrients from the soil and the water and the light that's provided from above. Okay, that these things are coming together to bring forth and to nurture faith within the heart. Okay, faith is growing. Okay, this is what's taking place daily as we keep covenant with him. Okay, that's the hope. When hope is in Christ, because truth has set your hope in this work of Christ within the soul. This is what's known as the operation of God within the heart. Okay, or regeneration. Okay, God is regenerating the soul. He's cutting away and purging that which does not reflect him perfectly, and he's forming within us, okay, the image of Christ. Okay, he's forming within us, okay, his knowledge. Okay, he gives form and structure to his knowledge through his stewardship. Okay, and he that's what our faith is building upon. Okay, because this forms the altar of Christ within the heart. Okay, and it's upon this altar that we're offering our spiritual sacrifices. The altar sanctifies the gift. Okay, the spiritual sacrifices are the gift. We're giving expression to Christ, giving expression to that which we had received. So our faith reflects Christ from above perfectly, not our own image of Christ, where we each paint our own image and we each have our own little flavor. Okay. That's not Christ. That's not Christianity. Okay, that's the world. That's all that is. Okay, it's a form of godliness without power. That's all that is. Okay, that's Antichrist. That's not Christ. Okay, so it's so Christ is the hope of the righteous who are joining themselves to him through the cycles of their growth. Okay, these are daily cycles of growth that we go through. And we are overcoming by choosing continuance. Okay, that's where we talk about conformity. Okay, we're choosing to remain within that framework of truth, consistency. We're daily exercising our faith with this knowledge and with these tools. And communication, we're giving expression to that which is taking place within the heart. Okay, these are the three C's. So this is how we're overcoming our cycles of growth every day. We are in expectation of his work of purging, scourging, cleansing, and healing within our hearts. Okay, that means your hope is in Christ. Okay, when your hope is according to these things, okay, then you have hope with understanding. Okay, now your expectations are going to be met by God. Okay, and so you're going to learn of the consistency of God towards those who show forth consistency of faith in Christ. As you keep your faith within the framework that God has established for your faith in Christ, then you will learn of his daily consistency towards you. Of becoming very actively involved in every aspect of your life, okay, which is what the church wants, but they don't have that. They're not experiencing that because they're standing outside, asking him to come out and play with them. Okay, he won't do that. Okay, you have to come into covenant. You have to come in to the house of the Lord in order to experience him daily. Okay, so you have to abide in him, then he will abide in you. So laid up here, he talks about being laid up in heaven. He's talking about prepared for the overcomers. Okay, it's laid up, it's prepared. So our hope, which is laid up in heaven, because our hope is not in anything earthbound. Okay, our hope is in our redemption, the redeeming of our souls from darkness, which has to do with the separation or purging of the heart from darkness, which has to do with the knowledge, false knowledge, any knowledge which is contradictory to Christ, has to be purged from the heart. So also the fruit of our working with that false knowledge, okay, that's that fruit of iniquity, that has to be purged. Okay, so God is separating us from the kingdom of darkness and from the power of darkness. Okay, that fruit which was within the soul is being purged from the soul, and daily he is filling us instead, okay, with his knowledge and his fruit. Okay, so he's not just cutting away, but he's also adding to and increasing. Okay? which is awesome. This is what we experience daily in covenant with him. So this is the hope of the righteous, isn't it? So our hope is in our redemption, that work of regeneration within the soul. This is the focus of God at this time. This is our focus. Okay, we are in agreement with him as to that which we focus upon. Okay, because he is setting our hope and our expectation in Christ working within us. This work of Christ redeeming the soul. Okay, you'll notice that they don't even hope for that in the false religious system. Okay, they don't understand that at all. Okay, their hope is very dim and very short, very short-sighted. So our souls being restored back to the light and being restored back to the bosom of the Father. Okay, that even as God received Christ back to him, so also does he receive our faith now when our faith is perfect, and so also will he receive us back to himself. All the way back into the bosom of the Father, which is our true origin. Okay, it's the true origin and the true destiny of those who keep covenant with God by this pattern. Okay, by this pattern. No other pattern, this pattern. No other spirit, this spirit. Okay, this is the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Okay, this is what Abraham was talking about. Abraham, being the father of faith, had the same hope. Okay, he too had his hope set in Christ. Okay, he was not yet experiencing that power which had not yet been provided for the purging of the conscience, okay, because that was yet to come. Okay, but his hope was still in Christ. Okay, this same pattern, okay, is what he was reflecting upon. The same pattern is what had been revealed to him. Okay, this same knowledge. But we are now in the fullness of it. Okay, it was being shown in part, okay, prior to Christ coming, okay, in his fullness. Okay, before it was in types and shadows and in part. Same pattern though. Okay, the actual tree was casting a shadow. The shadow was of the actual tree. Okay, so it's the same pattern. The shadow reflects the actual tree, right? But now the true tree is present in the fullness of Christ in the new covenant. Okay, that's what they were looking forward to. Well, now that's what we abide in. Okay, so why are people trying to go back to Moses in order to try to find some kind of roots for their faith? Okay, it's like going to the shadow of an apple tree because you're hungry. Well, that's not going to help you. Okay, it's not going to help you. You got to come to the true tree. Okay, so this is what Abraham had, the same hope, and he too gave thanks to God through the spiritual sacrifices which were sanctified by him for faith in the present covenant. Okay, it was a different covenant. And that covenant's no longer sanctified for faith, but it was sanctified for faith at that time. Okay, but when the pattern was revealed to Moses for the building of the tabernacle, you can no longer worship God through the things which had been sanctified for Abraham. Same thing when the temple of stone was built. Okay, you can no longer worship God through that pattern of the tabernacle of skins. Now, okay, the Spirit was sanctifying, okay, these new things. Okay, so you have to work with the Spirit of God, the present covenant. You can't mix old covenants, can't reach into future covenants. You have to work with the covenant which is present. Okay, that which God is presently sanctifying, that's what your faith must be joined to for your faith to be found in Christ. And when he says for you, he's talking about the saints and the faithful brethren in Christ. Okay, they're not they're not separate from the government, truth, and Spirit of God, but they're joined to Christ. Okay, they're not refusing government, they're not refusing stewardship, okay, they're not denying the need for apostles. They're joined to Christ through these things. Okay, Paul was not writing this letter generally speaking, but specifically speaking to those who had already been instructed in the faith and were fully functioning in the priesthood of Christ. Okay, they already had this foundation knowledge within their hearts. They were functioning in the priesthood of Christ, and he was writing to assist them, calling upon them to reflect back upon that that first foundation, okay, to their common experience as they're keeping covenant with God, functioning in this priesthood. Okay, and as he begins to address some of the things that they're being challenged with, because they're being challenged by those Judaizers that were trying to pollute their faith. And that's what Paul is writing to them, to strengthen their faith in Christ so that they could use that knowledge to keep themselves unspotted from the world, from the doctrine and the philosophies of those Judaizers who wanted to mix covenants. And so when he said here about you have heard before, okay, so Paul preached the knowledge that we received. Okay, these were also under the stewardship of a living apostle. Okay, they had received that instruction. And that's what he's talking about, that word of truth. That's the knowledge of the plan of God. Okay, Paul also used and shared the knowledge of the testimony of Christ, okay, the plan of God and our hope through participation with these things that join us to him and his work in our souls. Okay, we carry this same yoke of knowledge that we preach. Okay, Paul did also, so did all of the apostles. Okay, we are all held accountable to this one pattern, okay, this one power, okay, as we all work together with this one Spirit. And I went a couple minutes over here, so we'll go ahead and stop now and pick up at verse 6 next week. Try to get a little bit further. But there's it's just an awful lot to make sure that as we read through these epistles, okay, that we're understanding the perspective from which these things were written, okay, and that which is necessary for faith, okay, because it's when our faith is joined to Christ through this knowledge, through this pattern, through these tools, okay, that we experience the reality of Christ, okay, and we don't want we want to be free from that error in the philosophies that we had been taught prior to coming into covenant. So it's necessary for us to exercise our faith with these things. Okay, because it's through this that we experience that work of separation and that work of joining. Okay, that God is truly providing for the separation of our faith from the world and the joining of our faith to Christ, and he bears witness to that contact. Okay, that we have tangible substance within the soul upon which to build our confidence. Praise God. All right, well, at that time I will go ahead and shut down the video and turn the microphone over for the reading of sacrifices through the audio channel. Thank you.